Hello students, I am Dr. Ashok Mahadi. Welcome to my YouTube channel. I make educational videos for YouTube. I have made this YouTube channel for the benefit of the students. Those students who have missed my scheduled live lectures can refer to these videos and learn their topic. So let us start with today's video. Let's get learning. Hello students, welcome to my lecture videos. Today we will start with chapter number 3, Management and Financing of Working Capital. In this video, I will be covering following topics. Number 1, Introduction to Working Capital Management. Number 2, Need and Importance of Working Capital Management. Number 3, Types of Working Capital. Number 4, Factors Determining Amount of Working Capital Needed. Number 5, Methods of Estimating Working Capital Requirement. And Number 6, Problems of Inadequate Working Capital. Now, let us start with first major topic, Introduction to Working Capital Management. For better understanding of this chapter, I will first discuss a few basic terms. First term is capital. It is the amount of funds invested in the business by the sole trader or by the partnership firm. In case of non-profit organization, it is termed as capital fund. In case of joint stock company, we call it capital employed or shareholders fund or net worth. Now, this capital can be subdivided into two parts based on the nature of requirement. First part is fixed capital and second part is working capital. First, fixed capital. It is that part of capital which is invested in fixed assets of the organization. The lock-in period of this capital is till the life of that fixed asset. Estimation of fixed capital requirement is very easy. That is, once you have decided what fixed assets are to be acquired, then company can ask for quotations from different suppliers. This helps the management to get an idea about the amount which they need to invest in fixed asset. The second part is working capital. It is that part of the capital which is required to be financed day-to-day activities of the business organization. That is, for purchasing of raw material, paying for wages, and etc. Estimation of working capital is not that easy because the amount of working capital needed varies with level of business operations and management policies, like credit period to be allowed to customers, credit allowed by suppliers, time lag between the payment of wages and overheads, etc. We will discuss various methods of estimating working capital in fifth major topic in the same video. In short, working capital is the amount required to finance current assets reduced by finance provided by the current liabilities. So we can say working capital is excess of current assets over current liabilities, that is CA minus CL. If we don't consider current liabilities, then working capital is equal to current assets. This working capital is also called as gross working capital. As already discussed, estimation of working capital is not an easy job. Similarly, working capital management is also a tedious job, as we have to manage current assets as well as current liabilities. Working capital management should always make sure that current assets are large enough to cover current liabilities. Now, let us see a couple of definitions of working capital. According to Park and Gladson, the excess of current assets of a business over current liabilities. According to Satish Mathur, working capital management involves the management and control of the gross current assets. Now, we will discuss second topic, that is need and importance of working capital management. I have already taught you capital budgeting chapter, in which you have learned different methods like payback period method, ARR method, IRR method, etc. For any company, capital budgeting decision is the most important which involves investing huge funds like fixed capital. As compared to this decision, about working capital investing is less vital, but we cannot underemphasize it. So conclusion is that there is a need to manage working capital in efficient way. Shareholders are the owners of the company. All the activities of the organization are done to provide benefit to shareholders by way of maximizing shareholders' wealth. If working capital is managed efficiently, profits will increase, which will benefit shareholders. As we are already aware that increase in profits will increase shareholders' wealth, so earning profit is very essential. This can be done by increasing sales, and to increase sales, company should always have sufficient amount of working capital. We know that if goods are sold for cash, we get cash on the spot. That is, amount of sales doesn't get blocked. Against this, if goods are sold on credit, our sales amount gets blocked in debtors, which may be realized after 1 month or so. This leads to shortage of cash. So having sufficient working capital will remove this problem. Now we will discuss the terms over or under capitalization of working capital. The amount invested in working capital should be optimum, that is exactly how much it is required. 5 to 10% up or down is expected to vary. So, overcapitalization means you have estimated and financed more funds in working capital than what is actually required. Overcapitalization is not desirable as the excess funds employed will remain idle and will not earn any extra profits. Instead of that, it will increase our cost and reduce our profits because every fund invested has some cost. So idle working capital is hurting company due to the cost of capital. Similarly, undercapitalization of working capital is undesirable as it has many disadvantages. We will be discussing these disadvantages in the last part of this video. Some of the disadvantages are loss of reputation, unable to pay debts on time, etc. The maximum amount which is blocked in working capital is in the form of stock. Stock may be raw material, work in progress, and finished goods. And to some extent, it is blocked in debtors. As we know, company has to maintain sufficient stock of raw material, WIP, and finished goods. Company can buy raw materials either on cash or credit basis. The purchased raw material is to be maintained for sufficient time, maybe for 1 month or 2 month. Work in progress is nothing but raw material plus some amount spent on labor and overheads. Finished goods, these are complete in nature in all respect, that is raw material 100%, labor 100% and overheads 100% are spent on them. In every situation, the company management has to make sure that working capital is always positive, that is, current assets are greater than current liabilities. In simple words, the current assets invested in business should always be more than current liabilities. The company requires maintaining proper funds to pay off its current liabilities. Even if a company which has huge fixed assets but they could not pay their current liabilities on time, then it will hurt their image in the market. So this brings out the importance of working capital management. So students, now we will discuss types of working capitals. Some of the important classifications of working capital are as follows. The first type is gross working capital. We have already discussed what is gross working capital. It is nothing but total current assets. Total current assets include stock of raw material, WIP, finished goods, sundry debtors, bills receivable, cash and bank balance, prepaid expenses, etc. So when we say gross working capital, we don't deduct current liabilities from current assets. It's only current assets. Next term is net working capital. Net working capital is excess of current assets over current liabilities. So we get the formula, net working capital is equal to current assets minus current liabilities. Next type is positive working capital. We have already discussed even this term. When we say positive working capital, it means total of current assets is more than current liabilities. Just against this, we have negative working capital. When value of current liabilities is more than current assets, it is termed as negative working capital. We can discuss this in detail, because when we have negative working capital, one may feel that this is a bad case. No, this may not be a bad case, because you are able to raise finance through current liabilities, which covers your current assets. It means you are in a good position, your market standing is good. But this is a double-sided sword, because when you have more current liabilities than current assets, it can be risky also. Because if you don't have current assets to meet current liabilities, the impact may be very bad on liquidity. If you have to pay any current liability urgently, you may not have current assets against it. Next one is zero working capital. So it is just like breaking even. The values between current assets and current liabilities means both values are same. So we have formula, working capital is equal to current assets minus current liabilities, where working capital is zero. It means value of current assets and current liabilities is same. So resulting figure is zero. Next type is permanent working capital. As the name suggests, this working capital amount is locked up in the business on a continuous basis, so long as it is going to exist. Permanent working capital is of two types. First, initial working capital. The working capital amount which is required at the start or beginning or inception of the business is termed as initial working capital. In the initial stage, company may have to make arrangements for financing working capital. Next type is regular working capital. It refers to the normal current assets minus current liabilities, which an organization has to keep at all the time in the business throughout the year. As against permanent working capital, we have variable working capital. It is the working capital which is required for short period of time. Now working capital, that is variable working capital, is of three types. One, seasonal working capital, which is required by seasonal businesses. Second, special working capital. Sometimes business organizations receive special orders like export order, etc. At that time, this special working capital is required. Third type is peak working capital. The normal businessman sometimes may reach the peak of its business. It may get maximum sales order. At that time, they have to keep peak working capital. Next type is cash working capital. It refers to the working capital which is required to be kept in cash or cash equivalents, like cash at bank, short-term investments, etc. Now, let us start with next big topic, factors determining the amount of working capital. The first major factor is nature of the business. If the business organization is having a manufacturing plant, then it will need more amount of working capital as compared to an organization who is just trading in goods and services. Second point, size of business unit. If the business unit is huge, then naturally it will need more working capital. If the business concern is small, operating at local level, they will need less amount of working capital. Next factor which influences amount of working capital is length of production cycle. Production cycle means the total time period taken by the production process to complete the production. That is the conversion of raw material into finished product. If the production cycle is too long, then company will require huge amount of working capital. As against this, if the production cycle is shorter, then company will require less amount of working capital. Next point is need to stockpile raw materials. Sometimes some type of raw material is scarce, or even the suppliers put a condition to buy raw material in large quantities. In such case, company have to have more amount of raw materials, and to finance the stockpile of raw materials, the working capital required is large in number. Another factor is need to store finished goods. In some businesses like retail stores, departmental stores, etc., they have to keep huge stock of finished goods because they do not want their customers to return disappointed. So naturally they will need more amount of working capital. Next point is turnover of circulating capital. If the turnover of circulating capital, that is velocity of circulation of money, is high, in that case less amount of working capital will be required, since cash is realized very soon. Another factor which affects the amount of working capital is terms and conditions of purchase and sales. If the company is giving credit to its customers and buying raw materials for cash, that company will require huge amount of working capital. On the other hand, if company is getting credit from its suppliers and realizing sales on the spot, in that case company will require less amount of working capital. Next point is production policies. If the production policies adopted by the business organization are such that company will produce to the order, in that case less amount of working capital will be required. If company is producing anticipating the sales, in that case more working capital will be required. Inflation. Inflation also affects the amount of working capital required. During inflation, all the prices rise. Therefore, price of raw material also rise. The amount to be paid to laborer and for other expenses also rise. So this leads to requirement of high amount of working capital. Next point is technology. A firm which uses labor-oriented technology, that is traditional technology, in that case wages bills are high, so they have to make provision for high amount of working capital. As opposite to this, if modern technology is involved, then amount of labor involved is less, so less amount needs to be provided for outstanding wages or payment of workers. Next point is dividend policies. Dividend is the part of profit which is distributed amongst the shareholders. When company pays dividend, there is an outflow of cash, so which can bring a strain on the amount of working capital. So what kind of policy the company is adopting for paying dividend will also affect the amount required by the company for its working capital. If the company follows a conservative dividend policy, that is they are not inclined to give dividend every now and then, in such case the requirement of working capital will be very less. Next factor is operating efficiency. If the business is carried on more efficiently, it can operate in profits, which may reduce the strain on working capital. If the company uses its manpower and all the resources in efficient manner, it will reduce the wastages and will increase the profit. The profit which is realized in cash will also contribute towards working capital. So operating efficiency also affects the amount of working capital required. It may ensure proper utilization of existing resources by eliminating waste and improved coordination, etc. Now let us come to fifth major topic, estimating working capital requirements. There are five methods of estimating working capital requirements. First one, percentage of sales method. Number two, regression analysis method. Number three, cash forecasting method. Number four, operating cycle method. Number five, projected balance sheet method. Now let us see first method, percentage of sales method. In this method, we presume that there is a direct relationship between sales and working capital. Based on this, a relationship is expressed in percentage, that is working capital to sales ratio based on previous years, and an estimate is made about the future. Just like in ratio analysis chapter, how we decide relationship between two variables, same way in this method also, a relationship between working capital and sales is established, and that forms a basis for projecting future requirement of working capital. Now second method, regression analysis method. Even in this method, the relationship between sales and working capital is expressed, but instead of in a ratio, it is expressed in an equation. This method is based upon the statistical technique of estimating the desired value of a dependent variable from the past unknown, or rather known, value of sales. Third method, cash forecasting method. Students, I have already taught you cash budget chapter. In this method, same principles are being followed. So in this method, cash budget is prepared. The excess of receipts over payments represents surplus of cash, and excess of payments over receipts causes deficit of cash, or the amount of working capital to be arranged. This method of estimating working capital requirement involves forecasting of cash receipts and disbursement during a future period of time. Now fourth method, that is operating cycle method. Before I explain this method, you should know what is an operating cycle. Now operating cycle is a cycle of cash being used for purchasing raw materials. Now these raw materials get converted into finished goods, but before that a stage occurs, that is work in progress. So it means nothing but when raw materials are put to production, we incur labor and overheads, but this is a stage where they are not yet converted into finished products. So this stage is called as WIP, work in progress. Then once all the labor work is done and overheads are charged, they become finished goods. Now these finished goods are ready to be sold to our customers. When we sell them to customers, it becomes our receivables, which may be in the form of debtors or bills receivable. After a certain period, they get converted back to the cash. This entire operating cycle may be of 1 month or even 1 week. It depends. If the operating cycle is small or shorter, then the amount of working capital required is less. Now let us see how this method is used for estimating working capital. As I showed you above, the operating cycle method of estimating working capital requirement is based upon the operating cycle concept of working capital. The cycle starts with the purchase of raw material and other resources and ends with the realization of cash from customers. The speed or time duration, that is velocity, required to complete one cycle determines the requirement of working capital. Longer the period of cycle, larger is the requirement of working capital, and vice versa. The last, that is fifth method, projected balance sheet method. Under this method, estimated balance sheet for future debt is prepared by estimating values of all the assets and liabilities by following any of the previously mentioned method, that is 1 to 4 methods mentioned above. The excess of estimated total current assets over estimated current liabilities as shown in the projected balance sheet is computed to indicate the estimated amount of working capital. When we say projected balance sheet, it means we are going to project all the assets and liabilities. The estimate is made based on some past experience. Now let us come to last topic, problems of inadequate working capital. In our earlier slides, we had referred to this slide. Now, if the company has inadequate working capital, then it can face many problems. The first problem which may be there is failing to meet committed payments when due. Now, company buys raw materials from suppliers. The suppliers extend credit period, which may range from 15 days to 1 month, or if credit standing is good, they may give us 45 days credit. But when this credit period is over, the organization has to pay for the raw materials, otherwise it will affect the goodwill of the firm. Next reason or problem which will be faced due to inadequate working capital is scenario of stock out. Stock out means you are out of raw materials. There is no stock of raw material. You have to halt your production due to lack of raw materials. Now, if you have sufficient working capital, you can use them to buy new stock of raw materials. Next problem which may arise is loss of goodwill due to failing to meet obligations. This is just similar to our first point. If we are unable to pay on time to our suppliers or to workers, then there will be a loss of goodwill which may be earned over a long period of time. Next problem is loss of investment opportunities due to lack of funds. If you don't have sufficient amount of working capital, then if you have any opportunity to get heavy discounts may be lost because you have less amount of working capital. So having sufficient working capital help us to benefit from the opportunities which may arise from time to time. Next problem is inadequate working capital may lead to business failures. As you may be aware that if any creditor is not paid for in 30 days up to 90 days, then they can sue company, and this may lead to complete shutdown of the company. So to avoid this, there should be adequate amount of working capital so that the business doesn't fail. Next problem which may arise is underutilization of production facilities. If due to inadequate working capital, if there is a shortage of raw material or absenteeism amongst the workers, which will force company to operate at lower level, maybe 30% or 40% of its possible capacity of output. Now this will create problems since we spread fixed cost over the possible production, but if production is reduced, the fixed cost charge each product will go up, which will hamper the profits and the selling price of the company's product. Next problem which may arise is higher prices on procurements or missing cash discounts. If you have sufficient working capital, you may buy raw material for cash and you may enjoy benefits of cash discount. But if you don't have sufficient cash or working capital, you may be forced to buy raw material on a credit basis. So we may miss cash discount which are available on the spot for buying goods for cash. Next loss, damage to the reputation. Reputation is earned over a period of time, but if we very often try to avoid our commitments, then it will affect our reputation. Next, no payment of dividend. Paying dividend is a healthy practice so that the company's image is kept at high. But if there is inadequate working capital, the organizations cannot pay regular dividend and it will spread a bad message amongst the investors. The last point is, the business cannot take new opportunities. If suppose there is a new order or an export order is received by the organization, the company cannot meet it because the company has a lack of working capital. So keeping in mind all these problems which may arise due to inadequate working capital, it is suggested that company should always have sufficient working capital and adequate working capital which may give it benefits. Thank you. So thank you students for watching this video. We will meet soon with a new video.
So students, I am sure you must have liked today's video. If you liked it, do click like button and don't forget to subscribe to our channel and do hit the bell icon for getting latest updated videos. Thank you. So students, if you have any doubts or queries regarding today's video, do message us on our official Instagram account. The link is given below in the description. So that's it for today. Thanks for watching.